Good morning and happy Easter. Christ is risen. Alleluia. Alleluia. All of our songs today are from the hymnal, since they're not printed in the bulletins, the opening song of which will be number 540. 540. Thank you.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you always. My brothers and sisters, as we come before our Almighty God and Father on this Easter morning to celebrate the great gift of the resurrection that has been given to us, we first call to mind our sins so that we may prepare ourselves to celebrate these sacred mysteries. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that and may Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Kyrie eleison. Christe eleison. Kyrie eleison. Let us pray. O God, who on this day, through your only begotten Son, have conquered death and unlocked for us the path to eternity, grant, we pray, that we who keep the solemnity of the Lord's resurrection may, through the renewal brought by your Spirit, rise up in the light of life. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Peter proceeded to speak and said, "You know what has happened all over Judea, beginning in Galilee, after the baptism that John preached, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and power. He went about doing good and healing all those oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. We are witnesses of all that he did, both in the country of the Jews and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree. This man God raised on the third day and granted that he be visible, not to all the people, but to us, the witnesses chosen by God in advance, who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commissioned us to preach to the people and testify that he is the one appointed by God as judge of the living and the dead. To him, all the peoples bear witness that everyone who believes in him will receive forgiveness of sins through his name. The word of the Lord. A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Colossians. Brothers and sisters, if then you were raised with Christ, seek what is above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Think of what is above, not of what is on earth. For you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, your life, appears, then you too will appear with him in glory. The word of the Lord.
Certain times throughout the church year, we sing a song after the second reading called The Sequence, which, as the name implies, is following something. It reflects the main themes of the feast that we celebrate. I'm going to sing it now in Latin and invite you to join or watch along with me. It's number 1065 in the hymnals, 1065, and then you turn the page over and you'll see the sequence. 1065. This is a song that's been in the church for over 1,000 years, over 1,000 years.
Victime Paschali laudes, immolem Christiani, Agnus redemitores, Christus innocens patri, reconciliavit peccatores. Mors et vita duello, conflixere mirando, dux vitae mortus regnat vivus. Dignobis Maria, quid vidisti in via, sepulcrum Christi viventis, et gloriam vidi resurgentis. Angelicos testes sudarium, et vestus surrexit Christus pes mea, precedit suos in Galileam. Scimus Christum surrexisse, amor tuis verre, tu nobis victor ex miserere.
Be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. On the first day of the week, Mary of Magdala came to the tomb early in the morning, while it was still dark, and saw the stone removed from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and to the other disciple whom Jesus loved, and told them, "They've taken the Lord from the tomb, and we don't know where they put him." So Peter and the other disciple went out and came to the tomb. They both ran, but the other disciple ran faster than Peter and arrived at the tomb first. He bent down and saw the burial cloths there, but did not go in. When Simon Peter arrived after him, he went into the tomb and saw the burial cloths there, and the cloth that had covered his head, not with the burial cloths, but rolled up in a separate place. Then the other disciple also went in, the one who had arrived at the tomb first, and he saw and believed. For they did not yet understand the scripture that he had to rise from the dead. The Gospel of the Lord. I know algorithms cause people a lot of consternation these days, that they're going to take over the world and control us, but there's a lot of hope still You know, the other day I got in my YouTube feed a recommendation for this Jim Carrey commencement speech or graduation speech. And I can't stand Jim Carrey. So this thing clearly doesn't understand what it's doing if it's recommending Jim Carrey to me. Now, I know there might be some fans here. It's not. I'm not judging him. I'm judging you a little bit. But in any case, so I don't know, because I couldn't read it. I clicked on it, right? So I'm watching it. And now I have all Jim Carrey videos. But so I'm watching it. And he made this... I thought a clever way of expressing something that is relevant for us as we celebrate the resurrection. As he's telling these students who are going out into the world, you know, giving them his pearls of wisdom, I'm sure much of it was kind of nonsense, but he did get to the point where he's talking about the tendency for graduation speeches just to say that you're going to go out and your job is to change the world. Your job is to go out there and make a difference. Your job is to have an impact that no one else can have, and so on and so forth. And he was reflecting on that a bit and really getting to the point of it really comes down to our own pride, thinking that that's what we're called to do to begin with. But then going a little bit deeper, you know, that this is a desire to be, I don't know, well-known, or a desire to be powerful or influential, or to feel like you have meaning, that it's this grasping after, essentially, to make a name for yourself so that you can become immortal. You spend your whole life chasing these things that you aren't going to attain so that you can become immortal. And he goes, it's such a strange thing that we spend our whole life chasing after things when we already have it. Right? And so that struck me, right? For Christians, and understanding what the resurrection means and what Christ is doing today for us, that we can spend our whole life chasing after the wind, chasing after things, when we really think about it, we already have it. The gift of immortality has already been given to us in Christ, right? But there's that. At the same time, though, I think we have to take seriously what our natural tendency is. We do want those things. We do want to be great. That must be coming from somewhere. We do want to be well-known. A much better comedian, Norm MacDonald, he has this little skit where he's talking about Harrison Schmidt. He goes, you know who Harrison Schmidt is? It's like, of course not. Anyone know who Harrison Schmidt is? Right, he's one of the 12 men who walked on the moon. And Norm MacDonald's point is, if there's one way to become famous, there is only 12 alleged moonwalkers, and you don't even know who they are, except for a couple of them. If there's one way to stand out, it'd be, I mean, how many people can look up into the night sky and say, you know, okay, where's the moon? Oh, here it is, it's below me, right? Totally unique. We chase after things that, what was the point? You know, if that's what you're going to be famous for, and nobody, in just a few short years, we've forgotten who he was. Lent, what we've been going through is we've been following these readings during the Lenten season. We've really been preparing. Now, it's going to be a little bit different. It's not that we simply have immortality. But what we saw in those readings we've been reflecting on is that what the individual was looking for was right in front of them. The woman at the well, when she expresses that desire, Lord, give me this water so that I may not thirst again. Fulfill my deepest desires. And what does Jesus respond to her? I am he who is speaking to you. You've been looking for this, and I'm here. The man born blind. Lord, show me this Son of Man so that I may see him. I am he, the one speaking to you. Mary, when she's begging Jesus to raise her brother Lazarus from the dead, and she says, I know he will rise in the resurrection on the last day. And Jesus says, I am the resurrection and the life. In other words, the one standing in front of you is the one who is going to provide all of these things that you are seeking to begin with. That today, a lot of what this is about is rediscovering what we already have. that we've been baptized into Christ, and we've been given something that is so easy to forget. And so we spin our wheels, and we strive after things or run our lives just into the ground, hoping for something that we've already been given. Now, we might not be searching for fame. I think at a certain point in life, you realize you're not going to get all those things. But even if, just take, okay, not, maybe not world famous, but each of us has a world that you're living in. You have a circle of people who either depend on you or who you care about or whatever it is, or your work or whatever. We all have this little world. And maybe you don't have that desire to be world famous, but all of us have that desire to be recognized by those around us. We all have a desire to be appreciated. That's just the same concept of walking on the moon, but just in our own lives. And when we don't have that affirmation, right, we feel like something's wrong because it's shaking us up, and it's shaking us up because we're realizing that what I thought I could depend on, it's not really what I have. I'm not going to find fulfillment in that. Or even when you're trying to run your life and you're being responsible and you're taking care of other people and you're doing this and you're doing that and you're running against all these obstacles. You might, you know, be providing for your family, working diligently, and then you lose your job. It's like, okay, but I was searching, I was finding meaning in being able to manage my world, and now I don't have it. So it might not be world famous, it might not be world powerful, but in our little worlds, we desire to be noticed, to be appreciated, to make a difference with the people that we're around, and we're constantly frustrated in this. And in those moments, we have to ask the question, do I already have? Has Christ already provided what I've been looking for? Why do I have this desire to make a difference? Where did this come from? Because it's in our being, it's in our nature to do these things. We're strange creatures as human beings. We recognize that we're limited, and yet we're constantly striving for more. And that was those lessons of those three stories. You notice in each one of those, it's not that Jesus comes to the woman at the well and says, well, you're gonna keep being thirsty, you're gonna keep striving, and you're never gonna be satisfied. That's not the answer. The answer was him. In other words, he doesn't tell her to repress her desires for fulfillment. He simply points out that your deepest longing and fulfillment is going to come through me. Same thing with a man searching for truth. Same thing with Mary and Lazarus searching for life. Jesus doesn't say, he's dead. Didn't you get the message? He's in the tomb. It's done. Her desire for life was real. And Jesus is saying, I am the one. I am the life. I am the one who will provide that. The other extreme, right? So we can strive for greatness. The other danger, though, is to just become mediocre, to think that it doesn't matter, to take those desires that we have and say, well, you know, since I can't attain them, they must not be anything there. My brother, I've been waiting for Bob Dylan to go on tour in the United States for like a decade now. He keeps like going on all these random trips to Japan and Europe. The problem is he's touring with Willie Nelson and John Cougar Mellencamp. So I don't know what kind of audience this is going to be at this concert. It's going to be very strange, I think. But that's part of the problem is to watch Dylan, I have to sit through John Cougar Mellencamp. And I'm not judging him. I'm judging you a little bit, Mike. No, I'm not judging him, but this is why he drives me crazy. And it's nothing personal. It's just, if you look at his music, though, it's all about mediocrity, right? Ain't that America, right? It's about this, you know, I can't have everything I want, oh well, kind of attitude. You know, that we're searching out, you know, these, you know, the kid with the greasy hair, you know, that there he is listening to his rock and roll station, and he says, this must be my destination. That this is all I need in life. I just, you know, sit around working in the mechanic shop and good enough. You know, my life is going to be, you know, that when they're young, they used to dream of being president, but those are crazy dreams. It just came and went, and now we're content. You know, we have our office. We go on vacation at the Gulf of Mexico. Good enough. I mean, this is a guy, he named his greatest hits album, The Best That I Can Do. Oh, well, you know, I tried, good enough. I mean, and I think the pinnacle of this is there's a lyric, you know, with Small Town, or Will Pink, you know, Small Town, he goes, you know, I'm living in a small town, I'll probably die in a small town, and that's probably where they'll bury me. And then he goes, ugh, like, this is like what I'm staking my life on. I'm so proud of this fact that I'm going to be dead. Yes, right? That's the best you can hope for. It's very different than what we're doing today. But that's not the best we can hope for. The answer here, see how we're trying to go between two poles. This desire for greatness, but this intuition we have that we're not mediocre. And the answer to that is what we celebrate today, which is the resurrection of Christ, that we thread that gap, not by, on the one hand, making ourselves into God, and we don't do it by repressing the God-given desires God has given us for greatness. The answer is to be in union with Christ, that through his victory over sin and death, that when we are baptized and brought into union with him, everything in our life is transformed. And so you can have your small town life, but every part of your world, everything that you invest in, whether it's your joys and your sorrows, your successes and your failures, it doesn't matter, because as long as it's in union with Christ, because if it's in union with Christ, even the disappointments and the failures can be resurrected. The sufferings can be resurrected. And the joys, too, are in union with him. That is through that union that everything becomes meaningful. The second reading today from Colossians talks about how our life is now hidden with Christ in God. Our lives are hidden with Christ in God. If our lives are in union with Christ, it has now taken on this great quality. Our lives are truly powerful and truly meaningful. We're all searching for these things, things that we know we can't do ourselves, but who can do it? By being in union with God himself, that's where the greatness comes. It's that initial act of humility that says, I can't accomplish what I desire. Once you admit that and submit to Christ, then he raises that up in union with him. And it then takes on this power that it didn't have before, this meaning that it didn't have before. So desires are not to be repressed, right? But it's to allow ourselves to be honest with that. Lord, you've made me for something more than this. I know I can't do it, but I know you can. Just to conclude here, there's a great passage from Philippians that gets quoted quite a bit, Philippians chapter 4. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Might be familiar. That can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. That passage is often used in the wrong way. You know, if you're watching March Madness right now, I would not be surprised after a last second three-pointer for the interview after the game. Say, that's a lot of pressure to be on you at the end of the game. What was going through your head as you prepared for that inbound pass? Well, I was just thinking, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. And that's what happens. That's how I sank that three, right? That's not what that passage means. If you look at the context, what Paul is actually saying right before that is, he goes, I can be content in all things. In other words, my life can be meaningful in all things, whether I am full, whether I am hungry, whether I am rich or whether I am poor, whether I am suffering or whether I'm experiencing joy. That's just a summary, but that's the gist of it. In all things, I can be victorious through Christ who strengthens me. That's Paul articulating this point, that through our union, through his union with Jesus Christ, everything else in his life, it's almost like King Midas with the touch of gold. Everything in his life becomes golden. Doesn't mean that, he doesn't say, all my sufferings went away, all my failures went away, but even my sufferings and failings and disappointments have been resurrected through the victory of Christ on the cross. and everything I've been working for in life, everybody I've been investing in, everything I've been chasing, now is great, now is important, now has power. And so that's the task of this Easter, to remember that our lives are not to be wasted chasing after things that we already have. Christ has already given us the gift of immortality. He's given us the gift of having a life that's meaningful. He's given us the gift of truth, the gift of fulfilling our desires. Let's not try to fulfill it with everything else in the sun, under the sun. But today, after St. Paul's example, come before Christ and ask him to take our lives into his hands, to be in union with him so that everything we do can be in accord with our desires, which is to be great. So this time, let us stand. So dear brothers and sisters, through the Paschal mystery, we have been buried with Christ in baptism, so that we may walk with him in newness of life. And so now that our Lenten observance is concluded, we will now renew our promises of baptism, by which we once renounced Satan and his works and promised to serve God in the Holy Catholic Church. So I now will ask you, and you respond wholeheartedly with "I do." So my brothers and sisters, do you renounce Satan?
I do.
And all his works? And all his empty show?
I do.
Do you believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth?
I do.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was born of the Virgin Mary, suffered death and was buried, rose again from the dead, and is seated at the right hand of the Father?
I do.
Do you believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting? And may Almighty God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has given us new birth by water and the Holy Spirit, and bestowed on us forgiveness of our sins, keep us by his grace in Christ Jesus our Lord for eternal life. Amen.
Hallelujah. Word in our flesh, Jesus Christ.
So now, my brothers and sisters, let us bring our prayers and our petitions before our Heavenly Father.
For the church in this season of joy, may the Holy Spirit empower us to share the good news with all. Let us pray to the Lord. For all who serve in the judicial system and in law enforcement, may the Lord guide them in the ways of justice and peace. Let us pray to the Lord. For all who do not yet believe or understand, may the light of the risen Christ draw them to faith and the truth. Let us pray to the Lord. For all of us gathered here, may we be drawn more deeply into personal relationship with Christ through his loving power. Let us pray to the Lord. For those we are asked to remember, especially David Smits, Francesco Belcastro, Francesco Lopez, and Richard Malacca, we pray to the Lord. For the sick and the suffering, may they know the healing presence of Jesus. We pray to the Lord. For those who have died this past week, especially Diane Tangi and Marilyn Kwasniewski, may they find eternal rest. We pray to the Lord.
Heavenly Father, we ask that you hear these prayers we brought before you this morning, for we are confident you'll answer them through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Thank you.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Exalted with paschal gladness, O Lord, we offer the sacrifice by which your church is wondrously reborn and nourished through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, at all times to acclaim you, O Lord, but on this day above all to laud you yet more gloriously, when Christ our Passover has been sacrificed. For he is a true Lamb who has taken away the sins of the world. By dying he has destroyed our death, and by rising restored our life. Therefore, overcome with paschal joy, every land, every people exalts in your praise, and even the heavenly powers with the angelic hosts sing together the unending hymn of your glory as they acclaim.
Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts,
therefore, most merciful Father, we make humble prayer and petition through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, that you accept and bless these gifts, these offerings, these holy and unblemished sacrifices, which we offer you firstly for your holy Catholic Church. Be pleased to grant her peace, to guard, unite, and govern her throughout the whole world, together with your servant Francis, our Pope, and now in our Bishop, and all those who, holding to the truth, hand on the Catholic and Apostolic faith. Remember, Lord, your servants. And all gathered here, whose faith and devotion are known to you, for them we offer you this sacrifice of praise, where they offer it for themselves and all who are dear to them, for the redemption of their souls, in hope of health and well-being, and paying their homage to you, the eternal God, living and true. In communion with those whose memory we venerate, especially the glorious of our Virgin Mary, Mother of our God and Lord, Jesus Christ, and blessed Joseph, her spouse, your blessed apostles and martyrs, Peter and Paul, Andrew, James, John, Thomas, James, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Simon, and Jude, Linus, Cletus, Clement, Sixtus, Cornelius, Cyprian, Lawrence, Chrysogonus, John and Paul, Cosmas and Damian, and all your saints. We ask that through their merits and prayers in all things we may be defended by your protecting help. Therefore, Lord, we pray, graciously accept this oblation of our service, that of your whole family, which we make to you also for those to whom you have been pleased to give the new birth of water and the Holy Spirit, granting them forgiveness of all their sins. Order our days in your peace, and command that we be delivered from eternal damnation and counted among the flock of those you have chosen. Be pleased, O God, we pray, to bless, acknowledge, and approve this offering in every respect. Make it spiritual and acceptable, so that it may become for us the body and blood of your most beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, he took bread in his holy and venerable hands, and with eyes raised to heaven, to you, O God, his almighty Father, giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took this precious chalice in his holy and venerable hands, and once more giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the Blessed Passion, the resurrection from the dead, and the glorious ascension into heaven of Christ your Son, our Lord, we, your servants and your holy people, offer to your glorious majesty, from the gifts that you have given us, this pure victim, this holy victim, this spotless victim, the holy bread of eternal life and the chalice of everlasting salvation. Be pleased to look upon these offerings with a serene and kindly countenance, and to accept them, as once you are pleased to accept the gifts of your servant Abel the Just, the sacrifice of Abraham, our father in faith, and the offering of your high priest Melchizedek, a holy sacrifice, a spotless victim. In humble prayer, we ask you, Almighty God, command that these gifts be borne by the hands of your holy angel to your altar on high, in the sight of your divine majesty, so that all of us who through this participation at the altar receive the most holy body and blood of your Son may be filled with every grace and heavenly blessing. Remember also, Lord, your servants who have gone before us with a sign of faith, and rest in the sleep of peace. Grant them, O Lord, we pray, and all who sleep in Christ, a place of refreshment, light, and peace. To us also, your servants, who though sinners, hope in your abundant mercies, graciously grant some share in fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, with John the Baptist, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, Ignatius, Alexander, Marcellinus, Peter, Felicity, Perpetua, Agatha, Lucy, Agnes, Cecilia, Anastasia, and all your saints. Admit us to beseech you into their company, not weighing our merits, but granting us your pardon. Through Christ our Lord, through whom you continue to make all these good things, O Lord, you sanctify them, fill them with life, bless them, and bestow them upon us.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen.
At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy
we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. And the peace of the Lord be with you always. And let us offer each other the sign of peace. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter into my room, but only say your word, and my soul shall be healed. Just a reminder this morning, for those who will be receiving communion today, please be sure to receive the host in front of the Eucharistic minister before you then proceed back to your seats down the side aisles. Thank you.
Hallelujah.
I shall not die, I shall live and recount his deeds. This is the work of the Lord, a marvel in our eyes. This day was made by the Lord, we rejoice and are glad. Christ our Passover has been sacrificed, alleluia. Therefore let us keep this feast with the unleavened bread of purity and truth. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Number 931.
Come to the banquet, come to the feast. The victory won. He spent his life for greatest and for least. Praise him, the victim, and himself the priest. Come to the banquet, come to the feast. Eat the bread of life. Share in the singing, share in the joy, drink the cup of love. With heavenly bread makes those who hunger whole, gives living waters to the thirsting soul. Before your presence, Lord, all people bow. In this your feast of love, be with us now. Come to the banquet, come to the feast. Eat the bread of life. Share in the singing, share in the joy. Drink the cup of love.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Look upon your church, O God, with unfailing love and favor, so that renewed by the Paschal mysteries, she may come to the glory of the resurrection through Christ our Lord. In the bulletins is everything going on in the parish. There's a lot coming up, and so you're perfectly capable of reading on your own, I know, so just wanted to draw your attention to that. Immediately, though, this week, next Sunday, will be Divine Mercy Sunday, so we'll have a celebration here. The Knights of Columbus will be hosting a camp pancake breakfast. There will also be the Divine Mercy Chaplet offered at 3, followed by evening prayer at 4, so you're welcome to all that. And then in preparation for that feast, to receive God's mercy, there will be some additional reconciliation time. So it's a great opportunity to prepare for that feast. Christ went through a lot of work these last few days to redeem you. He wants you to receive that mercy, so don't be afraid to come during this coming week. The Lord be with you. And bow down for the blessing. You respond, Amen, after each part. May Almighty God bless you through today's Easter solemnity, and in his compassion defend you from every assault of sin. Amen. And may he who restores you to eternal life in the resurrection of his only begotten endow you with the prize of immortality. Now that the days of the Lord's Passion have drawn to a close, may you who celebrate the gladness of the Paschal feast come with Christ's help and exulting in spirit to those feasts that are celebrated in eternal joy. And may the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit come down on you and remain with you forever. Go forth, the Mass is ended. Alleluia. Alleluia.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia. Alleluia.
We'll conclude with 539 in the hymnals, the last two verses.
Life eternal and rejoices, Jesus lives who once was dead. Shout with joy, O deathless voices, Child of God, lift up your head. Patriarchs from the distant ages, saints of